showing that the drive-in felt more like it was the first Sunday of the fall. It was like 57 degrees when we started up the drive-in this morning, and the wind was blowing, so it was quite unusual for being this late in June to be that cool. We welcome all of you, give a special welcome to our visitors. If you're new in the Springfield, Clark County area, are looking for a new church home, and we want you to make St. John your new church home. We begin with the order of confession and forgiveness on page 94 in the front of your worship book. So I invite those who can do so without difficulty to please stand as we prepare our hearts and minds for worship with the order of confession and forgiveness. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with all our heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen.
God, who is rich in mercy, loved us even when we were dead in sin and made us alive together with Christ. By grace, you have been saved. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. Almighty God, strengthen you with power through the Holy Spirit, that Christ may live in your hearts through faith.
Amen.
Let us now begin our worship with hymn number 733, Great is Thy Faithfulness. Hymn number 733 in the back of your worship.
Welcome to St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. This is the fifth Sunday after Pentecost, June the 28th, 2015. This is opening hymn written by Joseph Chisholm. He was born in a log cabin. He wrote this hymn in 1923. It was the official hymn of the Moody Bible Institute and also Billy Graham's theme song, Great is Thy Faithfulness. Sing along with us, written by a poor man who wrote over 1,000 poems.
Great is Thy faithfulness. Great is Thy
Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Today, and our theme is Almighty and Merciful God, we implore you to hear our prayers, hear the prayers of our people. Listen for the theme.
Good morning.
Good morning.
For a minute, I all strangers in here, but then I realized I go to 8 o'clock, so I don't see any of you people. My wife is off to New York City, that's why she isn't here. She's not sick. The first reading from Lamentations, chapter 3, verses 22 to 33. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. The Lord is my portion, says my soul. Therefore, I will hope in him. The Lord is good to those who wait for him, to the soul that seeks him. It is good that one should wait quietly for the salvation of the Lord. It is good for one to bear the yoke in youth, to sit alone in silence when the Lord has enclosed it, to put one's mouth to the dust, there may yet be hope, to give one's cheek to the spider and be filled with insults. For the Lord will not reject forever. Although he causes grief, he will have compassion, according to the abundance of his steadfast love. For he does not willingly afflict or grieve anyone. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We're now singing responsively Psalm 30, fifth Sunday after Pentecost. The theme is Almighty and Merciful God, hear our prayers.
I will exalt you, O Lord, because you have lifted me. Brought me up, O Lord, from the dead. You restored my
chapter 8, verses 7 to 15. Now as you excel in everything, in faith, in speech, in knowledge, in utmost eagerness, and in our love for you, so we want you to excel also in this generous undertaking. I do not say this as a command, but I am testing the genuineness of your love against the earnestness of others. For you know the generous act of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sakes he became poor, so that by his poverty you might become rich. And in this matter I am giving my advice. It is appropriate for you who began last year not only to do something, but even to desire to do something. Now finish doing it, so that your eagerness may be matched by completing it according to your means. For if the eagerness is there, the gift is acceptable according to what one has, not according to what one does not have. I do not mean that there should be relief for others and pressure on you, but it is a question of a fair balance between your present abundance and their need, so that their abundance may be for your need, in order that there may be a fair balance. As it is written, the one who had much did not have too much, and the one who had little did not have too little. The word of the Lord.
And thanks be to God.
We're now singing the gospel acclamation. Our pastor is Pastor John Pollock. He's in the elevated pulpit. This is St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. Singing the gospel acclamation. Jesus is there with Pastor Pollock. He is reading the gospel. Two or three are gathered together. He's with us.
He strictly ordered them that no one should know this,
and told them to give her something to eat. The Gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated. A couple of announcements quickly. Share with you that our brother Terry Hertzinger was called from the church militant to the church triumphant early yesterday morning. The family will be meeting with the funeral director this afternoon, so please check the paper tomorrow on Tuesday for visitation and the time of the funeral service. So we ask that you remember his family in prayers and with your acts of sympathy. Also, I'm sure you realize that this Saturday is July 4th, so Sunday, since basically July 4th will be a week-long weekend celebration, I understand some people will have Friday off because of it being on Saturday, so Sunday we will recognize our nation's birthday through hymn and prayer and message, so that will be next week. Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. As you are well aware, this past Friday, the Supreme Court of the United States of America handed down a decision that changes the definition of marriage in America from now on. Up until that decision was handed down, which was greeted by joy by some and with much consternation by others, the decision until then had been that states set the guidelines for marriage. And if you ever studied state guidelines for marriage, you would see that in certain states that you could be married without parents' consent at an earlier age than you could in other states. And also, I can remember when Gina and I went to apply for our marriage license to be married here in Springfield at St. Paul. We went to the judge and we had to raise our hand. We had to swear we weren't an imbecile, mentally deficient, an addict, a drunk, the town idiot, and on and on, and swear we were none of those. So as we left, I told Gina, I said, boy, the state of Ohio sure makes it easy to get out of a marriage or to get into one. I said, if you don't want to get married, all you gotta do is say yes. Yeah, I'm a town idiot, or I'm the imbecile, or I'm an addict. I said, or if you're one of those and you want to get married, you just say, no, I'm none of those. So the states all had their own guidelines. Like in Kentucky, I think it was 16 you can get married without your parents' consent. Where in Ohio, it had to be 18. So a lot of people came to Kentucky to get married at 16. So with this decision, as I said, there was joy in some camps, and there was consternation in others. Immediately, church people began to make statements. The presiding bishop of the Lutheran Church Missouri Synod immediately fired off a letter saying that the Missouri Synod would hold to traditional Christian beliefs, that as Missouri Synod Lutherans, they were to treat any gay couples that came to their congregations and had been married in another state with respect and so forth, but that the teaching in the Missouri Synod would still be that marriage was between a man and a woman. The presiding bishop of the North American Lutheran Church issued a similar statement. The presiding bishop of the LCA, I get to see a statement from that office. Others who are more known nationally began to give all kinds of dire warnings about what this really meant. There was talk about that Christians now would become persecuted if they stay true to the biblical idea of marriage as a man and a woman. That churches could be threatened with their tax exempt status. That church universities and seminaries, if they did not go along, could suffer a lack of or withdrawing of federal aid. And an example was given how when the civil rights legislation was passed back in the 60s, a small private university down in South Carolina that did not allow interracial dating was denied federal funding because of that policy of denying interracial dating. So there's been all kinds of statements made, and all the while, nobody has talked about what is most important as children of our Heavenly Father, as brothers and sisters in Jesus Christ. And that is that no matter what happens in society, no matter what happens in the world, that we are not to be afraid, but only believe. That we are to take to heart those words of St. Paul in that 8th chapter of Romans when he tells us all things work for good for those who love the Lord. Now, one of the fears that has been trumpeted is that Christian pastors will be forced to perform same-sex marriages against their conscience and against their religious beliefs. Well, the First Amendment says that the government will not establish a religion. But then it also says it has a protection clause. It says the government will not interfere with the practice of a religion. Well, some will say, yeah, but churches marry heterosexual couples, so how can they deny a same-sex couple? Well, the reality is, I turn down weddings all the time. A pastor has a right to accept or reject weddings. If I did not reject weddings, I would have a wedding every weekend of the year, probably sometimes two and three on the same weekend. But there are certain standards that the church sets up for having a wedding. An example, a couple of months ago, a young lady called up the church and said she wanted to get married at St. John's. So our secretary immediately goes into how she's been trained by asking her, what's your church background? Are you active in church now? What is your reason for wanting to be married at St. John's? And so her answers were she'd never been involved in church in her life. She was not involved in a church now. She just always pictured herself walking down the aisle in the church to get married in this beautiful white dress. Well, then the secretary said, well, I'm sorry, the pastor will not marry you. Said, for Lutherans, marriage is something sacred. It's a worship service. If you don't believe in God, you don't have a relationship with God, you haven't been active at all in church life, there's no reason for you to get married in a church. Get married in a park or in a gazebo or in a hotel lounge or somewhere. And that's what happened. I've turned down probably this year as many weddings as I've performed. So there's a lot of fear going on that's not necessary. But still, as children of God and brothers and sisters in Christ, we should learn an important lesson from our gospel today. And again, I repeat, don't be afraid, just believe. In our gospel lesson, we have Jairus, a synagogue official. And he's coming to Jesus because he's afraid his daughter is going to die. And he bows before Jesus and he implores him earnestly, saying, my little daughter is at the point of death. Please come and lay your hands on her so that she will get well and live. Some translations have so that she will be healed and saved. So here Jairus comes out of fear, out of being afraid, coming to Jesus to solve his problem. And that is the first lesson that we learn from our gospel today, is that when faced with difficult situations in life, don't be afraid, come to Jesus. When you're facing a difficulty, when the day is dark, when a situation doesn't work out the way you want, when you have problems in your family, don't be afraid, come to Jesus. That's what he's there for. Those of you who are my age and older will remember Danny King, Dr. Martin Luther King Sr., the papa of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Well, Dr. King Sr. was the pastor of Ebenezer Baptist Church in Atlanta, and an early activist in the civil rights movement before his son became more famous with his activities. And one thing Daddy King would say to his congregation when the early days of the civil rights movement seemed to be dark and there wasn't any progress being made and it seemed like old Ku Klux had the upper hand, Daddy King would just remind his congregation and to those he would speak to at different meetings to keep looking up. Keep looking up. Keep looking up to Jesus. Put your strength and your hope and your faith in Jesus. Don't put your faith in the secular. Don't put your faith in human beings, because they'll let you down. Put your faith in Jesus. Keep looking up. So this Jairus, this synagogue official, is showing us what we should do. Not be afraid, but come to Jesus in belief. Come to Jesus in faith. There's an old Arab tale that says a fellow was leading a caravan to Baghdad. As he was going through the desert, he came upon pestilence. And he asked pestilence what he was doing. Pestilence said, I'm on my way to Baghdad. I'm going to take 5,000 people. So the caravan continued journeying toward Baghdad. Pestilence went ahead. When the caravan arrived in Baghdad, they discovered that 50,000 people had died. So the caravan did their training, did their business, packed up, headed back home. They were again in that desert, about the same spot when they were going to Baghdad, leaving Baghdad, they come into pestilence again. And the head of the caravan says, "Pestilence, you were unfaithful. Pestilence, you lied to me. You said you were going to take 5,000 people and 50,000 people died." Pestilence responded, "I did not lie to you. I was not unfair. I only took 5,000 people." He said the other 45,000 people died from fear. Fear can be a terrible thing in our life. Fear can paralyze us. Fear can keep us from functioning properly. Think about the early church. The early church existed with all kinds of pressures. The early church existed in a Roman Empire where there were all kinds of cultures. There were all kinds of ideas about marriage. There were all kinds of ideas about the family. But that didn't keep the church from growing. And the church wasn't affected by the cultures around them and their belief. The one problem that the church has run into in evangelizing Africa, especially North Africa, is that sometimes they have people convert to the Christian faith who have more than one life. Because they've been Muslim, or they've been some tribal religion that didn't have a limit on your number of wives. And the church found out quickly that in order to make the person get rid of the other wives, meant to send those women to a life of poverty and early death. Because no one would take them. In the eyes of their village, in the eyes of their neighborhoods, these women belonged to that man. So the church was faced with, what do we do about this dilemma of polygamy? Well, basically what they did was, it's kind of like what happens here in this country when we come up with a new law. You get grandfathered in on certain requirements. So the fellow with the wives was grandfathered into the Christian faith, but his children were taught that as Christians, you have one spouse, not many. But people are fearing. They're fearing that somehow our nation is going to be severely damaged. Well, we don't know that. Only God knows the future. And my faith is strong enough to leave that future in God's hands. Because God loves us and cares for us. And my faith is great enough or strong enough to not be afraid, but to just believe. To believe that, as St. Paul said, all things work for the good, for the good of the Lord. So come to Jesus when you're facing fear. Come to Jesus when you're discouraged. Come to Jesus when you're disappointed. Come to Jesus when the day is dark. Come to Jesus when the path is long. Come to Jesus when things just aren't working out right. Because Jesus will give us the strength. He will give us the ability. He will give us the faith to face whatever happens. Say the church begins to become persecuted if it doesn't recognize the Supreme Court's decision. Although, as I said, the decision was for the states. It has nothing to do with the church. But suppose we were. We have brothers and sisters all over the world who are being persecuted for the Christian faith. And as one of the early church fathers said, the blood of the martyrs is the seed of the church. We have brothers and sisters all over the world who are being not just persecuted for their faith, but killed for their faith. But they're not afraid. Because they believe. They trust in Jesus, and they know that what's awaiting them is far greater than anything they can have here on earth. So we should not be fearful, but believe. It would have been easy for Jairus to become discouraged once the people from his home came and told him that his daughter was dead. While he was still speaking, they came from the house of the synagogue official saying, "Your daughter has died. Why trouble the teacher anymore?" But Jesus, overhearing what was being spoken, said to the synagogue official, "Do not be afraid any longer, only believe." Do not be afraid.
anymore. Do not be afraid means to stop fearing. Stop being filled with fear. Just believe. That means keep on believing. And that's a message for us. To not be afraid to face the future. But to keep on believing. Keep on trusting in the Lord Jesus Christ. There was a family that went on vacation. They had an 11-year-old son and a 7-year-old daughter. And part of the vacation was that they were going into a cave. Like people go down to Kentucky to Mammoth Cave and go out west to some caves, famous caves out west. So they returned to this cave, and when they got to the deepest part of that cave, the tour guide flipped the switch and turned all the lights out so that the people could experience how quiet and dark it is below the surface of the earth. The little 7-year-old daughter began to cry. She was scared of the dark. Her brother put his arm around her and said, "Don't cry. There's people who know here who know how to turn the lights back on." And that's what Jesus is. Jesus is that light that comes to us in the dark. Jesus is that light. That light to even the darkest day. Jesus is that light that shines for us in those disappointments, in that discouragement, in the difficulties that we face each day in life. So again, the message is do not be discouraged, but believe. Do not be discouraged, but keep looking up. Do not be afraid, keep looking up. Then Jesus, Peter, James, and John, and Jairus go to his home. There as they enter the house, it's filled with people mourning the death of the daughter. Back in Jesus' day, it was a custom to have professional mourners. And then even the poorest people would have at least two people there playing a flute, playing sad music to mourn the death of someone. So Jairus, being a synagogue official, obviously was a person of some means. So as we're told, it was filled with people who were wailing and carrying on. And Jesus comes and says to them, "Why make a commotion and weep? The child has not died, but is asleep." The people laugh at Jesus, thinking, "The girl is dead. She's already cold. And what are you going to do about it?" So what does Jesus do? He ushers out everybody but mom and dad, Peter, James, and John. They go up to the girl. Jesus goes up to her, takes her by the hand, says, "Talitha kum." Little girl arrives. The girl immediately raises up, gets up out of the bed, begins to walk around. Jesus tells him to give her something to eat. Jairus' faith pulled him through. So that he was no longer having fear, but instead believed. As they were going, as we read, there was a woman who had had that issue of blood for 12 years and been ripped off by doctors so that she had no money left. Her faith was so strong, all I had to do was touch the hem of his garment, and I can be healed. And because of that faith she had, because she was not afraid but instead believed, she touched the garment and immediately she was healed. And Jesus, as he touched him, she comes to him, as it said, in fear and trembling. He says, "Daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace, be healed of your affliction." For some reason, here in America, it seems we have a tendency to overreact to everything. We either go too far one way or too far the other way, all the while forgetting our faith. Forgetting that Jesus tells us that we do not have to fear, but just believe. We may not understand what's going on. We may not see the bigger picture. But we know that God is in control. We know that Jesus is our Lord and that everything eventually will work. There was a freed slave who was known only as Uncle Charlie. As death drew near,
preacher read to him John 3:16 at his request. Uncle Charlie asked the preacher to read him John 3:16, so the preacher read it. Then Uncle Charlie asked for a pen. He said, I want to sign my name to that verse. And then after he signed his name there in the verse, John 3:16, Uncle Charlie laid back down in his bed. And as he began to take his last gasp of air, his last breath, he said, I ain't had to do nothing for my salvation but believe in Jesus. And I have shown that I believe by signing that verse. Uncle Charlie faced death without fear because he believed. We can face the changes and challenges of life without fear as long as we believe. We can face the changes and challenges of life without fear by trusting in our Lord Jesus Christ. It cannot be denied that Friday's decision will change the landscape of America forever. Whether it will be beneficial or not, as I said, no one knows but God, and we trust Him in the future. What you must do is to continue to believe, to not let yourself get all worked up every time something happens that you don't agree with, but instead, believe. Trust in Jesus. As Jesus tells us in Luke 12:25, quote, and which of you by worry can add a single hour to your lifespan? End of quote. Who by worry can add a single hour to your lifespan? So if you are against the ruling, don't worry about it. If you're for the ruling, don't worry about it. As a Christian, just leave it up to Jesus. We come to Jesus and keep looking at Him. Do not be afraid, but believe. One Christian writer has said it best. He said, quote, the way to take the fear out of living is to have faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. End of quote. No truer words were ever spoken. If you have fear because of what's going on, come to faith in Jesus, and He'll take away that fear. So, as we gather together today, do not let your heart be troubled by a changing world, but instead, remember to keep believing in God, keep believing in our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, and remember to keep coming to Jesus and looking up. Amen. Peace of God, which passes all understanding, will keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus.
Amen.
We will now sing, We Come to You for Healing, Lord, hymn number 617, in the back of your worship.
This is the hymn of the day, We Come to You for Healing, Lord. It's written by Herman Stumpfel. Follows the theme that God answers our prayers, which we ask in the name of Jesus Christ. This is the hymn of the day, We Come to You for Healing, Lord, written in 1923 by Herman Stumpfel.
Thank you.
And again, I invite those who can do so without difficulty to please them. With the whole church, let us confess our faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. And you may be seated.
Ben and Carol Glaze are our ushers. They're coming forward. The acolyte has the offering plates. This is St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. Our theme today is God Answers Prayer, and we pray in the name of Jesus Christ. We look to Jesus, we repent, we believe, we've just confessed our profession of faith, which is the Apostles' Creed. At the beginning, we repented as we confessed our sins. We love God, we love one another. We welcome everybody. Jesus welcomed everyone, the poor, the needy, the weak, and we are on their side. God is on their side. We welcome you to come to St. John's Lutheran Church. Help us to help those in need. Sit in the pews. We love you. We need you. We've had the first reading, second reading, gospel acclamation, holy gospel, the sermon. We do welcome everyone. We love everyone. We love our neighbors as ourselves. We love God. We love our neighbors. Don't be afraid. Just believe. And the hymn of the day was, Welcome for Healing, Lord. Flowers today were given by Linda Fox in honor of the third birthday of great-grandsons Isaac and Oliver Schunkweiler. We have beautiful flowers, fresh flowers, every Sunday. We welcome you to come to our drive-in service. It's at 8 o'clock at the Melody Cruise Inn every Sunday during the summer. Starts Labor Day and starts Memorial Day, ends Labor Day. Next Sunday is the 4th of July celebration. Melody Cruise Inn Drive-In, 8 o'clock, and 10:30 service here in our sanctuary. We welcome you to come. Repent, believe, love God, love one another.
That all may hear your word. Remind us that we are all one in you, Lord, in your mercy.
so that we can share your love with them. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Father, grant healing to the sick and be present with those confined to their homes or other places of residence of healing. We thank you for all leaders in this church, town, state, and nation. Help them to do your will so that we may continue to live in freedom and worship you. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
And to your hands we commend all those for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
For those who came in that difficulty, please stand as gathered together as one by the Holy Spirit. We pray as our Lord has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. May the Almighty and merciful God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, bless, comfort, strengthen, and keep you, now and forever.
Amen.
We conclude our worship with O God, our help in ages past, hymn number 632 in the back of your worship. Hymn number 632.
This hymn was written by Isaac Watts. It was played at the beginning of World War II. It was played at Winston Churchill's funeral. It's thought to be Isaac Watts' most basic hymn. He wrote the hymn in 1719. He's the father of English hymnology. Beautiful hymn, but it's been a great hymn to help the people of England and the people of the United States through World War II and through the death of Winston Churchill. Oh God, our help in ages past. Tuned us in, you wrote in YouTube, St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. Help other people to do this. Spread our ministry to others, especially to the shut-ins. Either show people how to do this on the computer, or you can take your own computer or your iPad over to the shut-ins and spread the gospel. We have the video here. You know how to get on to it. Watch our Sunday service anytime. You can tune in. We offer a Christian school. Registration is open now for the Christian school. We offer daycare. Tune in any Sunday. We thank you for joining our worship service this Lord's Day. We'd love to have you come in person. Sit in our pew. Help us. If you can't do this, we'd love to have you watching this on the video. I hope and I pray that God will continue to bless you this day and all your days. May God bless you. We will pray for you. Continue to pray for us and for our YouTube ministry.